So
shall we start? Everyone, this is Ali Azzedine for Generation for Education, our special day, Let's Share and Connect. And this is our third session. We started now with our English session, and the title of the session is How ICT and Media Literacy Experts Supported Teaching and Learning Community Remotely. I'm so excited to have Rawan and Luna from Wellspring Lebanon with me today. And whenever you have something related to technology, Rawan, what happens? Your computer stops. And so this is what happened now. I had, a technology problem, and I lost my screen, so I had to restart. I would like you to introduce yourself again. Now we are live on Facebook. We are recording the session, and let's give it a start.
Okay, thank you, Ali. Thank you so much. So I was introducing myself, and I'm going to do it one more time. Sorry for those who already heard about it. So I have 8 years of experience in teaching, 4 years as a math teacher, and 4 years as an ICT specialist, certified by Microsoft and by Adobe as an Adobe Creative Educator. And I have a YouTube channel. This is my information to contact me by email. There's Luna as well.
Hello, my name is Luna. I have 5 years experience as librarian, and I'm a certified Microsoft Innovative Educator expert. And this is a second chance for you to see my email in case you wanted to send me any question or any suggestion.
Amazing. So Luna and Rawan, I know many people are watching and they are playing the same role that you are playing, a media literacy librarian and an ICT coach or ICT coordinator. So you had a first question for us, and in the chat and on Facebook for all the people who are watching, let's hear what are your expectations from this webinar? What do you expect to learn about?
All right, so we hope everybody to type in the chat, because we will be discussing very important ideas in this webinar, actually, Ali. So we hope that you enjoy it as well and we add to your knowledge. Do we have any answers, Ali? Or do
Where are our attendees? Maybe if they are in Lebanon, they just woke up because of the time difference between Lebanon and Dubai. And the people on Facebook, they started being active. So let's say I would like to learn more about how did you integrate with the teacher during the learning online? What is the role of the librarian? And what did you do even once we are back now and students are not able to take books and real books? Brenda, she would like to know more about the equipment and how we can use different tools to engage children and using different media tools. Very good. So
so let's dig deeper, Ali. All right. Yeah. So in this webinar, we are going to talk about two main questions that we posed and we're going to reflect about. The first one is, what are some pillars of ICT integration? So we are going to dive deeper into different models and different ideas that were mentioned by international organizations. And in the second question, we're going to talk about how we can support the inquiry at home and how can we support it as ICT specialists or media specialists. So I'm going to take you to the first question, which was about the pillars. And over here, if you remember when I advertised for this webinar, we mentioned every teacher is a technology teacher. Why did we say that? Because that was mentioned in different documents that were international documents like Learning Community from the IB Docs. And because every teacher nowadays, especially in a virtual setting, is responsible for the technology integration and the learning and teaching through technology and technology itself. So from this end, I'm taking you to a model that was introduced in the IB documents, which is about learning technology, learning about technology, and learning through technology, and how we can maintain the balance when we are integrating technology. And I am sure you've seen this in physics and math and different areas, learning math, about math, and through math. So this is about technology, and this is how we kind of reflected about this model, and we noticed that in a virtual setting, and suddenly when we all went to a pandemic, okay, the emphasis became bigger on learning through technology. And then teachers had to kind of have a boot camp in order to up-level their skills and start integrating technology. So this is one of the main pillars that I wanted to talk about, which is understanding this model very well. And I referenced it down with this IB doc. Another idea that I wanted to talk about is discernment. So discernment is choosing the right tool that will help you serve your goal without having to spend a lot of time troubleshooting sometimes or having technical issues. So discernment is very important as a skill to have the ability to discern or to have the ability to choose which tool you want to use. It was mentioned by the IB documents. It was also mentioned by the ISTE standards and by Microsoft at some points in their online courses. If I move on, I'm going to show you an example. So this discernment is how you choose the technology, but I'm not talking about only electronic devices. I'm talking about, it could be an unplugged lesson, it could be plugged, but which tool are you using to emphasize this need or to reach your goal? So in the first example, you have a parallelogram and they used a set square and a compass. So this is the right tool for them to learn how to draw a parallelogram. In the second example, mental math practice. So for example, in this, you need to have an aid at home so that this the children are practicing mental math. And this is where technology comes very handy, the applications that we use on our mobile devices or the iPads. And the third example, and this is a very important example. For example, if you are an early years teacher, you want to teach the kids how to color an image, you're not going to use an application for this because you want to reinforce their motor skills. So you are going to use a paper and the pencil and the crayons to color. Whereas if you are teaching them about using the mouse and how you're practicing the mouse skills, or maybe the digital tools or the tapping on the iPad, you're going to use an application. So choosing or discernment is an important factor when you are planning your instructions or your learning experiences. Another idea, which is multiliteracies, I'm going to let Luna talk about it.
Okay, here I'm talking about multiliteracy. As we all know, that technology allows endless educational possibilities and activities, and it in order for us as educators to complete an educational success, we need to promote the ability to for our students to be literate in using multiple literacies. We all know that our students should be able to locate, to evaluate, to process information, and to, in addition, to communicate what they learned to others. And this is a very required, especially with all the flow of information and ideas that are currently available online. And in applying this, we need to think of the five literacies, which are digital, media, informational, critical, and design literacy. And here, maybe Rewan would like to go deeper into the design literacy.
Yes, I wanted to draw a connection between digital literacy and design literacy. When you are designing your experience as an educator, you want to make something for the students to learn at home or to inquire about it. You have to make sure that are they tech literate enough to use the tool that you are providing or the technology tool that you are introducing in this activity, or for you, are you tech literate enough to use this tool? So it's always very important to keep in mind how tech literate the students are at home while you design your learning experience. So this is what I wanted to talk, and this has to go also with discernment, what we mentioned before. I'm going to move on to the next slide. It's about multimodalities, Luna.
We all know that with e-learning and with the virtual settings, teachers were able to reconsider all the resources used to achieve a lesson, to achieve a unit, and virtual setting gave us an opportunity to use these multimodalities, like to use a variety of techniques, to use a variety of resources, of websites. And this allowed the students to learn at their own pace and to give the opportunity for differentiation. And of course, multimodalities can include visual, it can include audio, it can include text. Such, for example, like using different resources for the same lesson, such as articles, maybe we can use video, we can use music in order to achieve this lesson. Go on.
All right, so in the last idea that I wanted to mention about the pillars in ICT integration is computational thinking. Computational thinking was introduced first as a term, as a set of skills that we use to introduce computer science. But then in 2006 and by Janet Wing, and then later on, it was introduced as a 21st century skill, and that it's the fifth C. So if we're talking about creativity, communication, collaboration, and critical thinking, the fifth C is computational thinking. It is a way to decompose a problem, to use abstraction, and we use it a lot in troubleshooting, how to isolate different patterns and to choose to find out the solution and then build an algorithm to solve the problem. So computational thinking is now a required skill for 21st century students and for educators to learn about it. It is also a set of competencies that was introduced by the ISTE standards in collaboration with CISTA and NSF, if you want to Google them more. So in summary, we talked about five different aspects: technology, learning and teaching, discernment, multiliteracies, multimodalities, and computational thinking. Now, from this end, we ask ourselves, So I know those topics, I know those aspects. How can I manage to maintain those and to keep them in mind in a virtual setting? And how can I scale the technology integration? So in one of the ideas that, one of the models that I used in order to scale the technology integration in my school was the SAMR model, which was by Dr. Rubin. And the SAMR model has helped me know where am I right now as ICT integrationist or as an ICT specialist, depending on the ICT integration in my school, and where do I want my school to become? How do I want it to transform? So if you notice the SAMR model at the bottom, it has redefinition, modification, augmentation, and substitution. You can also search more about them and discover how you can use them. I'm going to show you how I scaled the technology integration based on the SAMR model. That's 3 years ago when I was looking at the ICT integration in my school. And I put all these applications that we used and I distributed them according to this model based on how we used them, because you might use a tool in different levels. But this is based on how we use them. Luna, would you like to share some of the experiences here?
Yes, here on, I would like to mention how we use the transformation tools. For example, I would like to stress on HP Reveal and how we included augmented reality on different resources, such as books. For example, students were able to see each other's book reviews by just scanning a barcode and seeing an augmented reality of what others think of the book, and thus they can decide if they can check out this book or not. I'm talking on my experience in the library. Another experience, we also added augmented reality to nonfiction books, and we tried to make an update of some information while adding also a scan code at the specific page where students can just scan and just read the updates of the information mentioned in the book. And that's a way that we can update our resources without changing them. I would also like to mention how we used the green screen application and how we created the news broadcast in our school. And it was very surprising how students were able to think outside the box and still use the green screen as a background, but add with some tricks and some in order to create some visual illusions.
Amazing. Thank you, Leona. I also want to mention Storyboard That, which helped us create experiences for the students to create their own stories and in digital storyboards. So that was like a cool experience as well. Let's take you into a chat. And I want you as our audience, please, to type in the chat some of the tools that you used to substitute, to augment, to modify, or redefine an activity. So how did you change an activity virtually using which tool? Or how did you replace an activity, a certain activity that you used to do in person with the students, and now you are doing it virtually? What did you use? Which tool? Ali, do you see any, so please.
So I'm back with you. Are you hearing me?
Yes. Very yes, good. We would like to see if in the chat we have some people
are interacting on Facebook and the people are asking if the session is recorded. I would say yes, it will be on YouTube, if it's not this afternoon, tomorrow. And that chat started now. Hamna, she said, I use the Kahoot app to design quizzes instead of having a pen and paper quiz. Bernadette, she's mentioning Nearpod. Bayan, mm-hmm. she mentioned the Wheel of Name. And then maybe if you tell us why you use this application, this also brings a lot of interaction, especially for the people who don't know this application or they are listening about the application for the first time. Shiha, she mentioned classroom screen, maybe to explain the lessons online. Right. Again, many of us, they know Jamboard and they've heard about Jamboard to conduct the quizzes online. And then Padlet, students used to write in their books, but now we are using an ebook to create stories. So we used Google Doc for modification and redefining. On Facebook, I still don't have interaction. There is sometimes, you know, there is a That's delay okay. between Facebook and here. We have a concept board, we have Prodigy Education, and more application coming in the chat, like Book Creator and Miro board. So Amazing. I'm sure that when you prepared for us and Luna some ideas from your school and what yeah. are the changes that you have done. So let's have a look what you are
Definitely.
Going to do.
Definitely. So we are going to show you some of the examples of
how I love you can this photo.
Yes, how you can substitute or redefine the experience for the students. Of course, we're not going to be able to show all the applications that we use. This is an example. So if we started with flowcharts and sticky notes, we replaced it with Jamboard and whiteboard. Another example, and you guys mentioned it, Jamboard. Another example is how we used to have a gallery walk and the chalk talk centers in the classroom. And now we replaced it with discussions on Padlet and how we can connect the ideas on Padlet. So it's been really helpful in a virtual setting.
And here, Rawan, I would like also to add that we can use these applications to create not only a gallery book, but also a virtual field trip. And that's very required now with the virtual setting hitting up.
Definitely, definitely. Thank you, Luna, for your addition here. Also, there is the polls and the tallies that we used to do on the board. And now we replaced it with the visual from Mentimeter, Answer Garden, or maybe instant statistics over here. So these are some of the examples. Of course, there are plenty, and you're going to see more in the next part of our session, which is how did we empower the learning community, the teaching and learning community. So Luna, this is your big role over here. Before that, we're going to start with two main points. So the first point is going to talk in a very big ideas about supporting inquiry. And the second part is a somehow tech. It's about user experience. So UX means user experience. I will elaborate more when I start with talking about it and troubleshooting. Supporting inquiry, here we go. So we have flipped classroom, which when we use tools to provide resources for the students to inquire, and then we evaluate when we embed in the same page or in the same presentation a quiz asked for them, for example. So this is the Google Sites or the PowerPoint, or it could be any tool, but you are gathering all these links, all this information that are related to a lesson, and you're telling the student to inquire, and then you're assessing his knowledge. It could be also an office form. And Luna.
And here I would like to talk about Bitmoji classrooms or Google classrooms. This is a trend right now, and this is a live example of a multimodality where we can create our own space, like or virtualize our own space. Here I tried to virtualize because I turned my actual library into a virtual one, and I tried to include all the services that are provided in a physical library but in a virtual mode. For example, here you can see that there are resources, book resources, there are video resources, there are articles, posters. Everything on this virtual library is hyperlinked to a specific website. How I do multimodality here in this virtual library is that it depends on the subject that we are learning about. For this is an example where we were learning about avatars and online identity. I tried to include this lesson in different modes of technology, such as we have a presentation, we have a song about online identity. We also had we also had a discussion on Padlet, so a student can learn at his own pace. If not from the article, he can watch a video, he can learn from a song. It depends on his way of learning. And one thing that I would like to mention while creating this virtual library is that I took into consideration my students' interests, and I was focusing a lot on the self-directed inquiry and self and what they like. For example, the Globe will lead you to a website that's all about map. And I added that because I know that my students are very interested in learning about maps and everything related to this concept. I would also like to mention the makerspace as how I virtualize my library. As we all know that in libraries, we're all moving into adding a space in there. Physical space of they were adding a maker space. I did not give up on the maker space even in the virtual library, and maybe Rawan will move to the second slide and show us how we can make an online maker space. We created this online maker space. There are plenty of resources that are available for free on the internet. You can just gather these websites in one place where students can just click on the virtual makerspace, and then they can access all these resources, and they can choose the one that matches their what they like. They mention their identity and matches what they would like to learn more about.
Exactly. Sorry, also here.
One thing that I worked on during the virtual setting is the access to resources. We all know that in virtual, in physical spaces, most of the resources that are used in the library are physical resources like books, encyclopedias, dictionaries. This thing has changed with the virtual settings. And one thing that we thought of, and I like to use a term used with one of my colleagues, which is to create a bank of resources. And this is what I worked on. I created this bank of resources, and I added different types of websites that allows, and I divided them up in accordance to what matches the needs of our students and our teachers. And here there's an example of the royalty-free sources. I also gathered everything related to royalty-free resources that provides us with media such as photos, music, videos that students can not only use during their media or library session, but also to use it as a reference in any other class, in any other research that they're working on, any other project. Another example is it's shown here how we can also divide, not only libraries, but teachers can also work on that. You can divide your resources in accordance to lessons, to units, and put them into different modes of resources, such as websites, books, and videos, and so on.
So this is another example of Bitmoji Classroom. So this became
let me just say that we just had a commenter one. We need ideas for KG. And here we go. We are going to answer your idea, Andrew, on the spot. So I'm not going to wait till the end of the webinar. So if you can elaborate a little bit on this one and Luna, how did you do it in KG? I know many KG teachers are watching us, and we have also webinars for them later on. So let's hear from you and from your experience.
So technically, this was a trend, as we said, Ali, and it's how we design and we make use of every single space in a slide so that we make it interactive with the students. Now, the EY, this is from an EY, a KG1 teacher, actually, and she was really nice sharing this with us, and we kind of supported her creating this Bitmoji Classroom. So she made use of every single hyperlink. So we call them hyperlinks, so those that we make them so that we click and they take you to a different place. This is how you interact with the PowerPoint or the Google Slides if you're using it. And she's used it to structure her sessions, to structure her period and how to say hi, for example, or even how to tell them the daily schedule or to make it as a reference for them to know on which day. So if they click on the flower, it will take them to the schedule of the day. And this is how they can, they have it as a reference and it's bookmarked for them. So it's good to tell, you know, it's easy for the child to tell him to just click there and not tell him copy this link and so on. And this is another one over here with a voiceover. And she also like hyperlinked different buttons over here if you click on them and they take you to different places. Also a reading center. So she made a reading center. So it kind of gives you the atmosphere of a homeroom. She created her own homeroom class digitally. And she points at where to click exactly. And those are different learning platforms here. Yes, Luna, you want
to add one note that I would like to add here, that Ms. Tamah also added, integrated different classes into her classrooms. She also added a place where it can lead you to another place, like it can lead you to a library, it can lead to the Arabic class. So I just wanted to just add this point. I thought it's important to mention.
Definitely.
how this area helped us also integrate as classrooms together.
Exactly, and she kept the reading corner.
Positive comments on Facebook and here on the Zoom chat. So let's continue. We have approximately half an hour left to learn more about your role what you have done.
Yes, go on, Luna.
So visible thinking routine, as educators, we are all familiar with the KWL chart and where students can assess their prior knowledge, what they want to learn and what they learned from a lesson. There are different ways we can do that virtually. This is one example where I use Padlet with citation. Before starting the lesson, we started with adding what are the ways that we can give credits or write a citation. And students just wrote what they think and how they think they can give credits to different resources, to different types of media. And after the lesson, these students came back to the same Padlet and they replied to their own comment with their new findings and with the new way they can write a citation. And here through my experience, I noticed how students, they were able to see how their learning have changed and how their comments have changed between before the lesson and after the lesson. And as I said, this and self-evaluated evaluate their learning. And as I said, this can be done with different tools. It doesn't have to be Padlet.
Exactly. And we take you to this point here where you gamified the experience for the students. Now we hear a lot about Minecraft for Education and how they develop lessons for the students. And they learn about science, math, and physics through the games, through the game Minecraft. And even you have other tools that are gamified as well. Even your own lesson, you can make it gamified with scores and rules and so on. So Luna can talk to you more about Kahoot as well. Go on, Luna.
Yes, someone mentioned Kahoot in the game, and then I felt, oh, there's a connection here. I also use Kahoot to track the learning and to evaluate the learning with my students. We can also start with a Kahoot game as a class and play the game as a classroom, and then play it again after the lesson and see how our score have changed and our answers have changed. I would also like that to mention that sometimes we used to integrate two technology tools together or more in order to achieve a goal. So whenever a teacher is designing a game or thinking of gamification, she needs to think of the goal and how she can achieve that. For example, sometimes I use Kahoot with the forms, and students start to vote for the answer that they think they because you know in a classroom we might have different answers and different thoughts. So we can unify these answers on forms and then use it on Kahoot.
Definitely, I want to add Luna. Yes.
Yes, and usually students, whenever they know that there is a Kahoot game in the lesson, you can tell that how much they are excited to learn, excited, attentive to listen. They want to learn everything. They don't want to miss anything. They want to have to get the higher score among all other classes. So this is a great experience.
Amazing. I wanted to mention here that as ICT specialist or media specialist, we are attending the planning meetings with the teachers. And sometimes you might not have a subscription for a certain tool, so you might need to provide an alternative. And this is where our role becomes very handy, because we have knowledge about different tools, and we try to suggest in the planning which tool will help you serve your goals. I want to share an experience with the grade 3 one time that we did. It was learning about materials and different materials. We did not have a subscription for Minecraft, but I provided a different application that can replace Minecraft and can serve our goal with the same concept. And it was an application, if you want me, I can mention the name, it's Blockcraft. So it's similar to Minecraft. You can download it on the devices and they can play it, and it will help them learn about different materials. So substituting the technology sometimes or being able to directly switch between an application and the other and make the connections is a very important factor for an ICT specialist or even for a media specialist as well. So I'm going to move on to this one. We're talking about Flipgrid over here, which of course amplifies discussions, as you may know. Luna, you want to share more information about that?
Yes, I would also like to share that also Flipgrid can be used in gamification. We all know that nowadays students have a lot of are using a lot of popular games such as Among Us or stuff or other types of games. A teacher can trick the learning by adding the rules of Among Us to a Flipgrid assignment, where students can just assign different missions to each other, and then we will end up with one product. So this is one idea that we can use also Flipgrid for the gamification purpose. Now, Flipgrid is a very important tool as for me as an educator. I think because it can be used in different ways. It can be used to assess the learning. It can be used for online collaboration. It also includes the Flipgrid Discovery Library, which you can find a lot of ready-made assignments or topics created by teachers. And every teacher can also share any topic that she created there and be a part of the Flipgrid community. There are also the trending topics on Flipgrid, and there are also the Flipgrid Pals, where you can find people that teaches the same subject, that has the same, that teaches the same classes, where you can collaborate with them. We tried in our school online collaborations through different tools. We tried Skype, we tried Flipgrid. As a reflection, I can tell that Flipgrid allowed our students to just allow their voice to be heard, allowed them to express themselves more than Skype. Like when we are in a classroom, it's different than when we are one-on-one and every student is receiving a reply to his own question. Made them feel very, very happy and very special, maybe by getting a special reply with a student. Another way here, I would like to go back to Padlet and mention the canvas that looks like a map, where students, after the online collaboration, can go back to this canvas and just add their information there at any place on the globe. For example, we made an integration with a collaboration with India, then they can go to India, click on India, and add all the points they've learned there. And this canvas can be shared among the community, not only through within one class. Rawan, you'd like to add?
Definitely. Yes, all those tools will promote for global collaboration, and it is very important as specialists to emphasize on the interest of the teachers and to kind of empower them and train them. So we kind of supported the community with how to use Flipgrid, and how we fostered this communication in the classroom by helping them and providing them with the right training that they need, or the supportive videos that they need in order to use Flipgrid with the classroom and to keep the discussions happening even in a virtual setting. Padlet, we used it as my colleagues mentioned, Teams, there's also Skype. There are different tools that Microsoft and other organizations are providing for us to collaborate and connect with schools outside our country. So it's very important to make use of them successfully. Over here, I want to stop a little bit. I want in the chat to ask you, what were some tools that you used to support inquiry virtually? So we kind of gave you examples, and we would like to hear from you. What are some tools that you have used in your inquiry?
Then while they are putting this chat and these ideas, I have two questions for you. And so let me take... Yes. The first question where they are so I need to go back to that chat. Asil is asking, can you tell us a little bit more about Makerspace and how is it done online, why the people are interacting and sending the ideas in the chat?
Okay, I typed the answer for Asil, but I'll say it again in case anyone else would like to know more about it.
Luna, you need to choose all panelists and attendees.
Okay.
And you are sending your answers so they can read it, but please read it aloud as well so they can hear you.
Okay, so an online makerspace is a place where students can go and just see all options of hands-on activities that can be done online, such as the coding, it can be Legos, it can be, and there are plenty of these activities online. So if you search hands-on activities for online setting, you can find plenty of examples. You can just collect these, the ones that matches what your students are into, and just add them in one place where students can access them easily.
Thank you, Luna. And then in that chat, we got many of the application that you mentioned and you explained in the previous slides.
We're ready. Amazing.
To continue the one.
Yes. So the last point that I wanted to talk about as an ICT specialist is the user experience and the troubleshooting. UX or user experience, we talk a lot about it in game design and in technology, in app design. So developers of games and websites and technology in general, they think about the user and how competitive will this application be when they are using it on their devices, because sometimes you might get a plugin not working for you on a certain device, and this has to do a lot with the design of your lesson. And when you're thinking about a technology tool, to integrate technology, you have to think about the accessibility and the compatibility with the students at home. And from here, I can talk about artificial intelligence and how it was used to get analytics for us and to collect information for us so that we know how to design our experiences. So over here, I'm showing you real analytics that came from my Google site. I have an ICT website that I use as an ICT teacher. And this has helped me, this data helped me a lot know what to design and how to advise the teachers about certain applications that they are using when they design the lessons. So for example, if you notice from my statistics, it shows the type of device, Macintosh, iOS, Windows, and you can see the users in which location. So it's for you to discern here and to look at the data that will help you know what you need to choose. Sometimes a teacher might come to me and ask me, okay, I want to use this in my lesson. I'm going to work with the students who use an iPhone or who use an iPad, or maybe you can download it only on an Android. So these questions are very important, and they are important factors for you to design your lesson and to make it successful at home for the student, because we're talking about equality and equity in education. And equity is very important, even when they are using the devices at home. If you notice, those analytics show that in my class, and that's not one class, I teach 19 classes. In those classes that I'm teaching, I can tell that, okay, most of my users are using iPhones, they're using iPads. So those applications that I'm showing you examples of here, they give you those analytics. So you have Google Analytics, you have Sway, it gives you the number of users and how many times they looked at it. SharePoint, it gives you the devices. YouTube Analytics, it gives you also which devices, and many other applications like VizMe and so on. And when we're talking about accessibility and compatibility, there's also in online learning where we used a lot of online platforms. And last year, we used 7 platforms for the students to have a good experience at home. Yes, so when you use 7 platforms, this means you have multiple accounts and then you have multiple passwords. And this was a big issue, which made it led us into working on a project, me and Luna, so that we unify the passwords for the students. And this was a big hit for us because this year it facilitated the access for the students. And we made a data sheet with the user accounts and the passwords. Luna, you want to share with them one of our experiences while unifying the passwords?
Yes. Thank you, Rowan, for mentioning this and for reminding me of this experience. As we said, we unified all of our passwords for the different applications that we are using with the students. But we have experienced that we all know that students nowadays are smart. And our students were able to just get the pattern of our password, and they started to just log in into each other's user. And that's a problem that we might face. They started to log in into their friends' users and change the avatars and stuff like that. We did not give up on unifying the passwords. Instead, we kept the passwords unified, but we added a format to it. For example, you can use a color code before the password or a shape before the unified password that you agree on and make use of it. And it's working till now.
So far, yes, it is. Thank you. Thank you, Luna, for this. Another idea that I wanted to talk about is that many organizations mentioned for us that we need to make videos that are short mini lessons for the students. Some of them agreed that it should be not more than 5 minutes. Some of them mentioned 6 minutes and some mentioned 7 minutes. You can see it in ISTE, in Microsoft courses, or even in the IB documents. They mentioned all of these, but in troubleshooting, when you are an ICT integrationist and you're trying to troubleshoot with the teachers, you're not going to send a video that is 5 minutes long. I started this way, and I gave you examples over here. So when I sent it to a teacher, it was overwhelming for her. She doesn't have 5 minutes to spend it on a video. And this, and from here came the idea of developing playlists, a chunk of videos that are not very long videos and maximum of 2 minutes, maybe a bit more than 2 minutes, but not more. It shouldn't be 3 minutes, for example. So with this chunk of videos, I am tackling a specific skill or a specific area in this technology tool. So which over here now, a teacher, if she comes to me and asks me about a specific option, I'm not going to send a 5 minute video. I'm only going to send a small video about that trick and that's it. So this has helped me a lot. And from this end, it came the idea of creating my own YouTube channel. And for me,
I'm sure you as my own resolution. Subscriber now, Rawan.
Exactly. And I created my YouTube channel and it became active. And then my YouTube channel became, as my colleague Shireen mentioned earlier, a bank of resources. Luna also mentioned my colleague. It's a bank of resources for the teachers and the students. They go to my YouTube channel, they search for the video, and they look at how to do stuff. So my channel is just to support the educators and the students. And then another homeroom teacher who transferred this skill, or she learned that from me, this channel, and she kind of took it to another level. She extended this experience into a YouTube channel for read alouds. So our colleague created her own channel for read alouds. So it served her own goal. She used discernment in this as well. And then it became a ripple effect. An educator taught another educator, and then an educator, yani, we have now many educators in our school who have their own YouTube channel with their own read aloud videos. So it's really important to have your own bank of resources as an educator as well. So from here, I will go back over here to using CT skills or computational thinking skills in troubleshooting, because those skills are very important when you are troubleshooting and helping the community, not only educators or not only students, also the parents sometimes, because they talk to you on behalf of their children, their young children. So when you are troubleshooting, you have to always question your audience and guide them with your questions in order to diagnose their problem, and so that they know how to solve it. And this way, the next time they have the same problem, they're going to kind of have the same mindset or the same skills that they used with you and try to solve it on their own first. So right now, as an ICT specialist, when I first started troubleshooting, it was 11. And right now, my students, when they come to me with a problem, they first tell me, Miss, I did this and I'm stuck here, because they tried before. And I know that, okay, so they used abstraction actually, because they were looking at different patterns that happened with them. And then they isolated different solutions so that they figured out, okay, this is my problem and I need to fix it. And then I asked them to list the steps that they used to fix it so that the next time they are able to do it on their own. And this is how I coach the teachers as well. This is how I help the parents as well when in a virtual setting. And it's a very important point to talk about here. So now that we ended, I'm going to talk about tips and hints that I can give for the community. So we have a lot of online courses. They are out there. They're for free and by many organizations. So you have by Microsoft, by Google, by ISTE, by IB. And I really encourage educators to start working on their own professional development, because this is like, they are there. You just need to start the initiative, you know? And another idea that I wanted to mention here is to always take advantage of teachable moments. So whenever you have a problem and you feel that, okay, this is going to occur with many cases, take it as a teachable moment and teach your students. And all of us as educators, we are responsible for teaching the technology, as we mentioned in the IB doc. We are responsible of ICT integration. So we have to troubleshoot with the students. It's not only on the ICT or the media specialist. It's also on the teacher, every teacher who is using technology. We have to empathize. We have to acknowledge the hard work of the teaching and learning community, and to keep records of your tutorials because you're going to use them later on. And my last is just reflect, always reflect, so that you make it better the next time. Luna, do you have anything, any more tips to add here?
No, I just like to thank everyone for sending us in the chat box and for asking these questions and for their participation. And I really appreciate all the tools that they also mentioned. As you said, Marwan, we need to take advantage of a teachable moment, and this is a teachable moment. I will also take another look at all the resources that the attendees have mentioned, and I'll try them out, and I'll also try to see where we can reflect and where we can take advantage of this.
Thank you. Thank you, Luna. I also would like to thank the audience, and I'm going to share with you our links. If you want to connect with us, I have a YouTube channel, Luna and I, we have Twitter and LinkedIn. Feel free to connect with us if you want. Technically, this is it, Ali. We hope that it was beneficial for the community.
So I got plenty of thank you on Facebook. I got plenty of inspiring session in the chat. And we still have for today, 4 session if you want to join us. A session about shared pedagogy with Anne Van Damme, a session about play therapy, a session about concepts in language, a session about concepts and how concepts transfers. So please, again, check our YouTube channel. The recording will be posted there, or you can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, join us on LinkedIn, or even Facebook. I hope you enjoyed our session. And our day is still a long day. We will have now a lunch break. Rawan and Luna, it was great collaborating with you. And thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ali. Thank you, everybody. Bye.